Hello, I'm Rodney Anderson, and work as professor of urology at the Stanford University School of Medicine in the Department of Urology. I've been associated with the Department of Urology at Stanford for 34 years now, and actually got interested in problems of infections, especially the genital urinary areas, many years ago. Dr. Thomas Stamey, a well-known pioneer in urology, is one of the first to really solve the issue of where does infection reside in the prostate. He dealt a lot with female urinary tract infections, and I had the privilege of learning at his side during those early years. It then became apparent to me and others that there was a lot more complexity to this issue of pelvic dysfunction, urinary disorders, and especially those conditions where we started to see pain. A lot of people were suffering from this, and a lot of urologists, gynecologists, family practice physicians didn't really have a handle on it, didn't really know what to do with it, particularly when people didn't respond to antibiotics. And Stanford University, as a tertiary referral center, became the sort of court of last resort for these patients. And we were presented with the dilemma of trying to figure out what was happening to them. How could we help them? It became obvious that searching for an infectious cause was not the answer. And over many years and through many good urologists and investigators, we've discovered that really in prostate pain, for example, only about 5% of all those who have discomfort and dysfunction of urination from the prostate have any kind of infectious process. So it began to be evident that there was something going on in the balance of the muscles and that that was responsible for creating some pain disorders. As women complained of pain, especially as they complained of bladder pain, we began to notice that there was a lot of dysfunction and characteristic patterns of pain in their pelvic muscles surrounding the bladder. I think the main problem with this disorder is that physicians have tried to implicate and cast guilt upon the organs. So they're constantly looking for some kind of a problem with the prostate organ, with the bladder organ, with the uterus, instead of looking at all the connective tissue and all the relationships between muscles and nerve function. I mean, it's amazing to note that we have 27 different muscles in and around the pelvis, some of them intimately associated with the glands and very responsible for coordinating function. An act as simple as emptying of the bladder requires good relaxation of the pelvis, requires a cognitive decision to allow the bladder to contract, and requires that the prostate and the bladder neck relax at the same time. You actually have three different nervous systems interacting simultaneously to create that. So when you combine that with inflammatory conditions and the sensitivity and all of the central nervous system reaction to this, it's no wonder that we are posed with this dilemma of figuring out what's going on with chronic pelvic pain. I wanted to talk a little bit about the patient that shows up in the physician's office and how we approach the evaluation, the diagnosis. It's not unusual for these patients to come after quite a long introduction of the pain. At least in the urologist's office, the gynecologist's office, they sometimes are referred by their primary care physicians, their internists, and they have not had any cancer discovered. They haven't had any infection discovered, nothing that is obvious on x-ray. And many times a lot of laboratory tests and x-rays have been ordered, which really reveal nothing that is substantive that can be treated. But the patient is continually having pain in the pelvis, chronic pelvic pain, often associated with their excretory function, meaning when they have urination, it causes their urination patterns to be more irritable, makes voiding more difficult. It's a factor in their bowel movements and also very much in their sex life. So these are complaints that the patient has, and they tend to come up and down in severity. There's no question in my mind that stress and anxiety can make these things worse. They then have difficulty coping with it. They may not be able to see a physician. Understandably, sometimes they receive powerful medications, even as much as narcotics, anti-inflammatory agents. They become dependent upon those kinds of treatments. At Stanford, we utilize a National Institutes of Health questionnaire for men. We have a National Symptom Question Index for women, especially those with interstitial cystitis. Following that, then we want to be involved in a good physical examination and try to localize where the problem is occurring. I want to make sure I don't feel anything abnormal in the rectum, and we go through the standard evaluation to make sure that nothing has been missed. And then the key point is in the examination of the pelvic muscles. The physician has to take the time to really look for the source of pain, particularly true for discovering specific trigger points. And that requires a little time. We'll do an abdominal exam looking for any tenderness or soft or irritated spots, a genital exam. I'm particularly interested as a urologist to make sure there's no scarring, that there hasn't been any trauma. And then we examine internally to determine whether the muscles have these sore spots. And we sometimes call those trigger points. And these are very sensitive areas that very little stimulation will elicit a sense of discomfort in these patients. And I really believe when we're able to find these kinds of trigger points in the patient, we're more likely to be able to help them. These are myofascial, meaning they're muscle and fascia or connective tissue related. What I think has been overdone and a big waste of American healthcare dollars is the money that has been thrown in trying to get x-ray images, fancy blood tests. In my experience over the years, I have not found that a CT scan or an MRI has been helpful in any degree. So this is a waste of money most of the time. If there is a lot of urinary dysfunction and that there is pain with bladder filling, I think it is important for us to make sure there isn't an inflammatory component in the bladder itself, sometimes known as interstitial cystitis. The inflammatory process feeds on the muscular pain, and it just becomes a cycle of pain that is difficult to break. And that's the object of our strategy, is to break that pain and get this patient to heal themselves. We have to keep in mind what the objective is, and that is to give this patient a new quality of life, reduce their pain, and hopefully over time completely eliminate it. I've made a little list of symptoms. So in the pain arena, people often have a lot of discomfort in the base of the pelvis. Some men talk about feels like a sitting on a golf ball. And once again, sitting seems to trigger a lot of these pains. Associated with that is an aching and a sensitivity even in the testicles, so they always are having to kind of squirm around to figure out what position is helpful. Some of that pain is in the lower back. Feels like it might be a back problem, but it's usually lower down. Some of my patients will complain of the pain radiating into the groin and into the thigh. And this is one of those common areas that is complained of. And then there's a suprapubic, that meaning just below the belly button, there can be discomfort. Now, in addition to those pain symptoms, we have this sexual dysfunction. With men, it can be pain after ejaculation, with orgasm. With women, it's pain during sex. where it's just a contact kind of discomfort. And there's a lot of anxiety about having sex. And men will often have ejaculation problems, and they will often have difficulty attaining erection. It's well known that a pain like this in the pelvis can be very distracting to the nerves, which are responsible to create the relaxation that's required for a greater erection. Then, of course, there's the discomfort and dysfunction of the bowel movement, that even having the bowel movement can be painful, or even afterwards. This is very upsetting for people. It creates a lot of dismay. People have had to quit their jobs. They have had to go on disability in some cases because of the devastating effects of this, and it becomes a spiral downward, and they become quite despondent and depressed about this problem. We call it the Stanford protocol because Dr. David Wise came to me many years ago with some concepts of how a lot of this chronic pain is centered in the pelvic muscles, and there's a neuromuscular focus, and that there are these trigger points that need to be addressed. And so together we worked with patients, and he developed excellent techniques of teaching the patients how to mentally control some of this using a technique that is now called paradoxical relaxation. Stress and anxiety is just pouring gasoline on the fire that feeds these muscles, which are already sore and tender. We've put this together in this book, Headache in the Pelvis. We're coming out with the fifth edition, and each time we rewrite this, we find new concepts, and we can report on some of the research that we've done with the patients that we've seen over the years. We published a paper to look at sexual function, for example, in men, and showing that over time, given myofascial release, cognitive paradoxical relaxation training, these men are able to regain their ability to have a better sex life. We then looked at these patients and took normal individuals, normal men that don't have any problem with pelvic pain, and compared them in terms of what is their personality like? What is the psychological aspects of their lives like? And how much stress do they actually suffer? How much physical dysfunction do they have? And when we administered these questionnaires, it was very clear that you could see the discrepancy between a normal group of men and these men. And then we had them take saliva samples to see on a daily basis what's happening to their cortisol. Cortisol is the gasoline that feeds the body. And we found that a lot of men with pelvic pain have cortisol that arises very quickly in the morning. And then we have now done some work where we bring these patients into the hospital and we are stressing them in the afternoon when the cortisol is normally low, and we're surprisingly finding that the stimulus for producing cortisol is quite blunted in these people with pelvic pain, so that when they are stressed with these structured tests, that they don't respond as well as a normal individual. One of our earliest research projects was to evaluate over a period of time what happens to these individuals when we have administered our Stanford protocol. These were men who came to us who had had multiple therapies of other types and had never been able to resolve the issue. Using the myofascial trigger point release and the paradoxical relaxation, these patients were then followed from at least 3 months and sometimes up as long as 2 or 3 years. You have to remember, these are individuals who had an average of 5 years of pain before we had a chance to work on them. So we were happy to see at the end of that time when you evaluated these patients, we had 70% of the individuals say that they were markedly better or moderately better. These are individuals that have made a lot of progress, and we're continuing to refine the protocol and have discovered that if we can get in these pain patients to come and visit us for a 6-day period and have time to work with them on a daily basis, spending more than just an office visit to work on the pelvic pain, to work on those muscles and work on their paradoxical relaxation training. This is giving us even better results, and we're just doing the analysis now to compare that with the way it started out in the beginning.